Welcome to the Happy Lawyer Project. I'm your host, Akoma Maronu, and I created this show to help lawyers find happiness in life with a law degree. Together with my guest, we provide the knowledge, skills, insight, inspiration, and encouragement you need to find your happy. Before we get to this week's show, I just want to say a huge thank you to this week's sponsor, Common Bond. If paying off your student loans is on the top of your list for 2018, and you're interested in refinancing those loans at a lower rate, I definitely recommend you check out Common Bond. Not only do they have some of the best rates in the market, but they're also super committed to giving back and using a portion of their proceeds to fund the education of students throughout the world through an organization that I love called Pencils of Promise. If you're interested, head on over to commonbond.co/happylawyer to check out your rate. And don't worry, there's no commitment. But if you do decide to go for it, our listeners will get a $200 cash bonus for using our link. So, on to the show. For those of you who listened last week, I had a wonderful episode with certified financial educator Tia Chambers about how to get your money right in the new year. And this week, I'm going to do another money episode, but this time we're talking about side hustles. And this week, I'm excited to have on my very first law student. Jaimey Castillo is a 3L, wife, and mother to 4-year-old daughter, and last year, she completed over $100,000 of sales on her eBay store. On today's episode, we chat about how Jaimey got into the eBay business, how she manages her conflicting responsibilities, and all of her big goals for 2018. Whether you're looking to start your own side hustle, looking for inspiration to get more done, or just interested to hear more about Jaimey's fascinating story, I think there's a little bit of something for everyone in this episode. Enjoy! Welcome back to the show, you guys, and I am excited to introduce you guys to Jaimey. Jaimey, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having me.
No, my pleasure. I would love if you could start with just a brief description of who it is that you are and what you do.
Okay. My name is Jaimey Castillo. I'm a mother, wife, law student, and small business owner. I'm in my third year of law school at Michigan State University. I've also owned and operated my own online clothing business for going on 5 years now. And I'm a mother to she recently just turned 5 years old, 5-year-old daughter.
That's so wonderful. And you are our very first law school student on the show. So I'm really excited to have you on. And I feel like it's been forever since I was in law school, but at the same time, like it was just yesterday. So how are you finding law school?
It's challenging, but I really do enjoy it. I've always loved researching and writing. So I really enjoy that aspect of law school. I enjoy reading cases and I love observing in court and things like that. So I've found it to be very, very interesting so far.
Is it what you expected?
It was actually harder than I expected because I was used to when I was in my undergrad, working on my undergraduate degree, I was like, don't want to toot my own horn, but I was at the top of my class. And then going to law school, you realize that everybody's smart. Everybody there is smart. So you're competing with all of these people that are very smart, trying very hard, and were probably at the top of their classes in undergrad. So that was kind of a shock to me, but I end up really enjoying it. I enjoy the academic aspect very much.
It's good to hear that you're enjoying it. And I think that that's a very common experience that people have, is that law school is harder than they expected, but at the same time, manageable, if that makes sense. I think I expected it to be hard, yet it was even harder than that. Yet I was surprised I was able to rise to that challenge.
Right. After the first semester, I feel like the first semester is like a huge wake-up call. And then you sort of get into if you can hang in there for the first semester, then you can get into the groove of it. And then once you get past 1 year, then it gets even more manageable.
Absolutely. And why did you originally decide to go back to law school?
Well, I have always been really interested in criminal law and always thought that I would be a criminal defense attorney. So with that goal in mind, I got my bachelor's degree in criminal justice, thinking that would be a good background for to become a criminal attorney. I've also always been really interested in the like the penal system and, you know, some of the issues that we have in our country with mass incarceration, things like that. And so, like I said, I've always been interested in the criminal justice aspect. So I went to law school with the intention of going into criminal law. At this point, I've been exposed to so many different kinds of law that I'm not 100% positive what I want to do yet. But sort of the nice thing about going to law school and owning a business is that I don't feel like I'm in a huge hurry to decide. I don't feel as though I need to make up my mind right this second. It's kind of owning my own business and having that income has kind of given me the time to step back. And currently I'm part-time in school. So it's nice that I've been able to slow down a little bit to really think about it, to really figure out what I want to do.
I think that's really great. And I think that's a great transition into your store and your business. But before we get there, I just want to note that I think too many people kind of hurry through things without knowing where they're headed. So right. It's great that you are kind of taking the time to go through school and be more intentional and really open to the idea that even though you went in with one idea about where it was going to go, that it could lead to something else. I think sometimes people become so dead set on, I'm going to be a IP lawyer without even really knowing what that means. And then they rush through school and they get their first IP job at that firm that they heard of, you know, 5 years ago. And then they look up and they're like, I hate this, you know?
Right. I've heard so many lawyers say that actually, that they say things like, well, I thought I was going to be this kind of lawyer. And then I ended up being this kind of lawyer. And it's wildly different from what they originally wanted to do, you know, and they're happy still. So it works out.
No, absolutely. If you had told me that I was going to be an aviation lawyer, I would have laughed in your face. I was so sure I was going to do, like everybody, international law. I even got an LLM in international law and, you know, worked at the UN and Amnesty International. And I was so sure that was where I was headed. And now I get to do a lot of international work, but I think that the area in which I'm in suits me better.
Right. You never would have thought probably in law school that that's the kind of law you would go into.
To be honest with you, didn't even know it existed. It didn't even occur to me.
I never knew it existed until you just told me.
Yeah. No, it didn't even occur to me that it was an area of law that someone could specialize in. So,
wow.
Yeah. But let's go into your business because I think it's so exciting what you're doing. And I stumbled upon your Instagram account a couple months ago, and you were talking about your goal of hitting six figures in sales last year. And I thought that was just so interesting. And I wanted to catch up with you and share that story. First of all, how did it go for you? How was last year in the business?
Last year was great. Yes. So I did set a lofty goal of $100,000 in sales on eBay alone. I do sell on multiple platforms, Poshmark, Amazon, Bonanza, other sites like that. But eBay is always my main focus. So I said, I want to do $100,000 on eBay. And I'm happy to say that we exceeded it by $2,000. So
congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm thinking it's only $2,000 over, but we made it.
Over is over. One penny over counts.
Yes, exactly.
That's fantastic. So I'd love to hear the story of how you started the business and why you decided to go into kind of retail clothing particularly.
Well, the interesting thing is that I never really planned to start a business this way. I was actually working on my bachelor's degree and working at the same time. I had a job. And then when my husband and I had our daughter, I stayed home with her for about a month or two. But like I said, I was still in school and finances were not good at the time. So I knew I needed to go back to work. So after I started working, my daughter we had to put her in daycare. We really didn't have a choice because neither of us could stay home with her. So we ended up having a really awful daycare experience where she was neglected. And that just, it was so hard for me because I felt guilty enough being away from her at that young of an age. But then to have that happen, it really just set me back. It made me feel terrible. So I told my husband, I said, I think it would be best for me to take some time off to be with her. I know it'll be financially hard, but we really need to do this for her. And so he was like, oh yeah, of course, you know, go ahead. And in that time, I was also sort of buying and selling things just sort of casually on eBay. I'd buy a lot of her baby clothing and stuff like that in bulk, and then also started selling her baby clothing that way too. And it just sort of opened my eyes to this online marketplace where you have the potential to really sell anything. And it seemed like it would be, the next step would be to possibly go find things that we didn't already own to sell for a profit. So I started doing that, just sort of slowly going to thrift shops, buying things on clearance and reselling them on eBay. And I was so surprised by how much money you could make doing that. It just had never occurred to me. So it was sort of by accident that I stumbled upon it.
So how, that's so fascinating, because I think that I struggle to sell like one thing on Craigslist because I don't have the patience for it. And so I'm like very, I don't know if you listen to Pat Flynn's Smart Passive Income, but he always has these people on who have these great side hustles and who do things like this and are really quite successful at it. And, you know, I'm one of those people who listens to it, tries it once and it doesn't work. And I'm like, ah. So I'd be interested to know kind of how much time did you invest early on, and when, like, as you ramped up, how much time do you spend on it now?
I think early on, I probably didn't invest as much time because, like I said, I didn't go into it thinking, oh, this could be a business. I honestly didn't even realize that it could be a business until I started getting into social media. I didn't know anybody that sold on eBay or have anybody that I, a friend or family that got me into it. It just was sort of by accident. But when I got into social media and I started joining like different eBay Facebook groups, thrifting groups, and I met people that were taking it seriously as a business. And that's when it opened my eyes. I thought this could be a business. So at first, I didn't spend that much time until I realized that I wanted to commit to it as a business. At this point, I would say that it's pretty much a full-time job for me. I do spend many hours putting time and effort into my business. I've gotten smarter about a lot of things, though. I used to spend a lot more time sourcing products, but I've gotten a lot smarter now about sourcing. I also have two very part-time employees that help me with the listings and the photography. So I think my time now is just spent differently. I do a lot of the back-end stuff. I'm working on some deals right now with, I have some wholesale deals, and I also have some deals with some major thrift shops where we just buy used clothing in bulk. So I spend a lot of time researching, actually, like how to take this to the next level.
I almost think that the way you did it, by stumbling upon it based on something that was interesting to you, is almost the best way. Because I think so many people have an idea, and instead of trying it first, they do the research first. And I don't know about if you agree, but maybe if you had known about all the Facebook groups and all of the resources and all the people doing it, you would have been so overwhelmed and intimidated by it that you just wouldn't have started. But because you already got out there and had done a little bit and it built on it slowly, it was a little bit more manageable.
I totally agree with that. I think that that is sort of one of the downfalls of social media, is that You join all these groups and you can learn a lot from other sellers and from other entrepreneurs, small business owners, but then it can be overwhelming when you see the things that they're doing. Sort of like what you were talking about with the different podcasts, where you see the things they're doing and you compare yourself to them, when you really shouldn't. You should only compare yourself to the you that you were yesterday, the you that you were last week. You know, work on your own growth as opposed to looking around at everybody else's. And it can be hard, especially for this type of business that is there's such a, the reseller community is really growing online. So you see all these different sellers, big sellers, small sellers, and it's hard not to compare yourself to what they're doing. But the best thing is to just keep your head down, focus on your own goals. What I like to do is when somebody is saying, this is how they do something, this is how they advise other people to do it, I really just take the ideas that I like and implement those and then basically just discard the rest because I know what will work for me and what will not work for me.
I think that's great advice in everything, right? And that's whether it's being a student or being a mother or being a reseller, really knowing your own values and kind of what your own strengths, weaknesses, challenges, all those things helps to not get lost in the noise. But I would love to dive into kind of the details of what you do. How Sure. do you really go about knowing if something will sell? Do you just kind of put everything up there? And what do you look to make? Like, are you one of those people who's buying things for 50 cents? Like, you're buying like pounds and pounds of clothing and, you know, selling it for, is it a bulk business for you? Like, you're selling a lot of things for a dollar? Or are you looking for higher end things? What's your strategy? And how did you come to that strategy?
Well, the thing that I sell the most of is women's clothing. So that's pretty much my specialty. So I do source other items, but I like to sort of stay in the women's clothing category because that's what I know really well. As far as profit for individual items, some sellers prefer to do what they call like the quick flips where they sell things. They buy cheap and then they sell it cheap, but as long as they make some kind of profit, they're happy. And then there's others that prefer only to sell the high dollar items. And for me, I like to think that I'm more in the middle. I like to sell high dollar and low dollar. The thing about eBay is you want to generate as much traffic as possible. So eBay likes a moving store. So if you're only selling high dollar items, there aren't as many buyers for those items. So you may only sell an item once every other day or something like that. I like to have daily sales. So I would say that my ideal profit margin on an item is probably $10, $15, to be honest with you, which may not sound like a lot, but it really does add up and it guarantees. And that's, I think, what most people, the price range most eBay shoppers feel comfortable with. So it guarantees you that constant movement, the constant sales every day. And like I said, that's where I feel comfortable. I do sell things that are lower dollar than that, higher dollar than that, but that's what I like my average to be about.
And right now in your business, what kind of would you say is a good day?
A good day as far as sales?
Yep.
For sales numbers? We've had a lot of really good days lately. I'm happy as long as it is between $200 and $300 in sales a day. I would say 200 is a slow day for us. 300 is where we like to be. And then anything between like 500 and 700 is possible for us, but that's more of a rarity.
That's so fast. And how long did it take to get to this point? So I assume, so how much did you make your first year that you were taking this seriously as a business?
The first year I did 18,000 in sales, and it wasn't a full year. That actually really surprised me and felt like a lot to me. I didn't take that for granted at all. I thought, wow, I was shocked that you could make that selling things online. So especially used clothing. I mean, I never would have dreamed that. So the next year I did 30,000 in sales, and the year after that I did 60, and then obviously this year I did over 100,000. So it's amazing. Been a steady growth.
Yeah, that's certainly, and I'm sure that along the way you've tried things that didn't work. What's your process like for trying out new techniques, new strategies? As I said, I have a tendency to try things once, and I'm sure that that's not the best way to go about things, but I don't know if you've had an example of something you've tried that just didn't work and kind of how you decided to kind of go back or reverse course.
Yes, I've had lots of things. I've tried lots of things that didn't work. I mean, everybody in this business, you will have bad buys. Like you purchase, for instance, I made a big wholesale purchase and I got it and I thought, you know, I think this stuff will sell pretty well. And then it hardly sold, you know, it was a bad investment. I did that incorrectly. I bought the wrong product, but for me, it was a learning lesson. It's like, well, okay, from now on, I know that this brand in this style, this isn't going to sell for me. I mean, you just have to, you can't beat yourself up over it.
Yep.
When I first started too, I made a lot of mistakes. Obviously it's an online business, so you have to ship everything. So when I first started doing the shipping on items, I would miscalculate the weights. I would, you know, underestimate the cost. So some of the items I even lost money on, and it was really discouraging. I thought, how could you be so foolish? You're losing money, but you just have to keep plugging along, figure out what you did wrong, tweak it, keep moving forward.
I love that you share that you know, kind of were losing money on items, because I think that people assume that other people get it and that they're not making these kind of silly mistakes or like, I don't know. I think we always assume that other people know secrets that we don't know and are less riddled with self-doubt than we are.
Oh, right. Exactly. It can appear that way sometimes, but honestly, I believe that anybody that is successful at anything, if you actually ask them and they tell the truth, they'll say that they made so many mistakes to get to where they are. Because I think that's really the only way that you learn. That's really the only way that like the lessons stick with you. Because you're like, I really don't want to repeat that mistake. So you strategize and plan how to not make that mistake.
It's interesting that you say that, because I kind of was putting together my list of lessons that I learned last year. And one of them was that success is a terrible teacher. And I think that for so long I was avoiding failure, but through all my success, I hadn't learned that much about myself, because I was really just picking things that I knew I could succeed at.
Right.
And I wasn't stretching myself and growing. So I have to remind myself always that just because I could be successful at something doesn't mean I should be, and that maybe I should do the thing that I might fail at so I can learn a little about myself and about this new area.
Right. Getting out of your comfort zone is so important, but it can be so hard. Absolutely. I'm not saying it's easy. It can be so difficult.
It's definitely easier said than done. And right. I also would love to touch on, because I think it's so interesting, your YouTube channel. So how did that get added to kind of the whole business, and why did you decide to go that direction?
That is actually a really good example of getting out of your comfort zone, because that was so hard for me. It was very, very difficult. The first video, I started and stopped it about 10 times before I was like, okay, come on, you're just going to you're going to do this. So it was hard, because I never have been the sort of person that likes to like put myself out there like that. But I ended up really enjoying it. And the reason that I started it is because at school, the school was running a social media contest with the grand prize of like $1,000 or something like that. And I sort of looked at that as it was an opportunity for me to get myself out of my comfort zone, to do the things on social media that I should have been doing anyways to promote myself and my business. So it was a really good catalyst for me to start doing that. And I was very nervous about it, but YouTube ended up being not nearly as scary as I thought it would be. It was actually, I met a lot of really interesting people, and people were more accepting, and the reception was far more positive than I could have ever imagined. So it worked out nicely. I'm very thankful for that.
It's reassuring that you say that, because I've had record video on my to-do list for 3 years now. I have bought and returned lights. I've bought and returned a camera. I've bought and returned, you know, I just can't seem to get past that like hurdle. of like actually hitting record, and I'm not sure why, but this year, 2018, I'm putting it out there to the universe. So
you can do it. It can be so intimidating. It really can. I was really surprised. So when we did the social media contest, we had to make a big presentation at the end to the judges. And I've said to the judges that YouTube scared me, that I was terrified to do it. And one of the judges said, really? You would never know.
Oh, I agree. And I thought, completely. Having watched you on video.
I thought about that and I thought, oh my goodness. I don't know how I pulled the wool over people's eyes that I wasn't absolutely terrified, because I was.
Well, you appear to be a natural. You seem very comfortable in front of the camera.
Oh, thank you.
So it's clearly something that you were inclined towards. How do you get it all done? So I suppose you have part-time school, you have a daughter, you have the YouTube channel, you have to source and, you know, manage your part-time employees. It seems like there's a lot of moving pieces. What do you kind of think about when you're thinking about managing your time, your priorities? How does that work for you right now?
Well, at first it was very, very difficult. So when I started law school, like I said, I didn't anticipate how hard it would be and how demanding it would be. So I was very nervous that I wouldn't be able to continue my business. But there was a point when I really did think, I thought, okay, something has to give. Either I can't do the business or I can't do law school. I can't just give up on my family. So there were three things sort of pulling me in different directions. And I actually sort of had a heart to heart with my mom. And I said, Mom, I think I have to give something up. And she said, why? Nothing has to be perfect. And it never occurred to me that those things didn't have to be perfect. As silly as that sounds, when she said that, it was really a turning point for me. And I thought, no, I enjoy all of these things. I know I can handle all of these things, but doesn't have to be perfect. I can just do the best that I can do. And it is still difficult. Sometimes I do feel like I'm being pulled in three different directions, especially as a mother. You feel that guilt of, am I spending too much time on school? Am I spending too much time working on my business? Am I not spending enough time with my daughter? But the further I go along, the better I get at managing that. And I also believe that organization plays a big role in that. I'm sort of a naturally organized person. I have a planner. I plan my day every day. And I also have a lot of good family support, people that are willing to help me. But what I sort of realize about that, about having people to help you, is that you also sort of need to organize them. I mean, someone will say to you, you know, I'd like to help you. How can I help you? You have to have something to tell them. You have to know what your needs are.
That's such good advice.
I think I've got
good
at that. Yeah.
I feel like so many people miss that part, and they find themselves unable to leverage kind of their support system because they don't even know what their needs really are and what they can delegate. And people hold on to so many tasks that I'm just like, just let it go. Just right. Let someone else do it. Just make it doesn't need to get done at all, maybe. But that's such a good point that as an initial inventory, you should figure out what your resources are and then figure out what your needs are.
Exactly. I think a lot of people just know, they say, I'm stressed out. But you really need to break that down and find out why you're stressed out, how you could be spending your time differently. And like I said, if you really look, there's, I'm sure, you know, for the majority of people, they have people that are willing to support them and help them. They just don't know what to do for them. They can't, you know, read your mind. You have to be able to tell them.
Yeah. And in general, I find that one of my mantras that I tell myself as I get more senior in my career and I have to manage more people is that if someone does something, someone who is capable does something incorrectly for me, it's more likely than not because I did not explain it to them correctly than that they were trying to screw it up or not being helpful or being lazy, you know. Because if I'm able to do it and I know they have the skills to do it, then there was a breakdown in communication between me getting that skill from my head to their head.
Right. I completely agree. And I've had to learn that too, just having employees, which I was a very new experience for me, was that exactly the more succinctly you can communicate to them, the better that it's going to work out for you. And if you need to explain it a different way, then give them that opportunity. Because maybe you didn't, they can't read your mind is the whole premise, I guess, is you have to be able to communicate. And if that communication doesn't come out right, try again, try something else.
So I'm looking at the time and I want to just get a couple more questions in before I let you go. Since it's the beginning of the year, I'd love for you to share, if you can, what your goals are for the store, for your channel, kind of what are you up to in 2018?
Okay, so for 2018, I have not actually even set a sales goal this year. I did set one last year and I was really happy to reach it. However, this year I'm sort of taking a different approach. I want to set goals as far as our productivity, how much we're going to be listing, how many new listings we're going to get up on eBay. And then also I have one giant goal is that right now my business is based in my home. And in order for us to expand and hire more employees, we really need an outside space. So I could rent an outside like office building or a place in an office building. However, I would prefer to buy a building. They have, you know, small ones available around me. So that's part of my goal for the year is to get that done. And if not do that, then be set up to be able to do that the year after. So to expand the business and focus on, instead of like a lofty year goal, maybe make like weekly goals. So it's more easily attained than like a big lofty year end goal. So we're just going to do that differently this year. And I think that will keep me more on task. And like I said, sometimes it's hard to set those like those big goals. You need sort of a how step. Like, how are you going to reach that big goal?
No, I love that. I think that sometimes it's important to track inputs instead of outputs. We sometimes get too focused on output, and output isn't always under our control. So Right. You can control how much you post on eBay, and you can really push yourself to post more and to be more visible. And, you know, there's only so many buyers out there. And the hope is that, you know, as much as you put in, you'll get back out, but you're not as focused on the sell side or the buy side, I guess.
Right.
And buying a place is a huge undertaking and such a big decision and so exciting. I immediately start in my mind. As soon as you said that, I was thinking of all the ways you could structure it to
right.
benefit your business. I was like, I hope you could buy it with one LLC and then lease it through your other LLC so that you're not keeping it as a liability on your balance sheet. But that's what happens when I'm an asset finance lawyer.
I was going to say, you would be a good person to talk to about that.
Well, yes. This is why even lawyers need lawyers, because the thing I specialize in is helping people finance assets, and I help people, you know.
Wow. So that's right up your alley.
That's, you know, the only way that airlines and companies can finance big aircraft. They can't afford to put them on their books because they're too expensive and they're such huge liabilities. So creative financing is an important part of the work that I do.
Yes, I bet.
That's very exciting. So for everybody who's listening and interested in learning more about your story and following you on social media, what is the best way for people to do that?
Well, I am very active on Instagram. I'm Law School Thrifter on Instagram, and that's also the name of my YouTube channel. So this year I plan to be, I'm going to try and be more active on YouTube and be more dedicated to uploading videos, you know, weekly or biweekly, something like that. So people can basically just know when to expect a new video from me. So I've also upgraded my equipment a little bit. I got a new microphone and things like that. So hopefully the quality will improve as well.
Fantastic. And I will include all of those links in the show notes at thehappylawyerproject.com. So people who are out on a run or on the subway and don't have a pen handy can head over there and check it out.
And I just want to say a huge thank you to you, Jaimey, for coming on today and being a part of the project. I love sharing people's stories, especially people who are kind of doing things their own way and not necessarily following that conventional path. Before I let you go, I have one last question, which I ask every single person who comes on the show, and that is, what do you believe separates happy lawyers, or in your case, law students, from those that struggle to find happiness in life with a law degree?
Well, I think one of the biggest things is finding balance. I know that's especially hard for law students and lawyers because usually you're so dedicated to your work, but it really is important to find balance for your mental health, focusing on your family and your own well-being. And then also one thing that has brought me great happiness is my contribution to helping other people. I believe that you should celebrate your own accomplishments as well as the accomplishments of others. And through my YouTube channel and social media, I like to teach people how to start a business, how to maintain a business. And I think that has actually played a big part in my happiness because giving back to other people, you get so much more back than you end up getting so much more back than you give. And that's always been really important to me.
I completely agree. Thank you so much, Jaimey, for being on.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a lot of fun.
Thanks so much for listening this week, you guys, and joining me for the Happy Lawyer Project podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please feel free to share it with your friends. And I'd love for you to head over to iTunes and leave a rating and review. I want to say a huge thank you to everyone who's already left a review, sent me an email, DM'd me on Instagram, or reached out to me in any other way. I truly appreciate you and love hearing from you. And I want to just remind everyone that this week's sponsor is Common Bond. So if you're considering refinancing your student loans this year, I would definitely head over to commonbond.co/happylawyer to check them out. As a reminder, you'll receive a $200 cash bonus for using that link. Until next week, I hope everyone finds their happiness.